Sup guys, Zero here, and welcome back to DDLC Summer Hope. We're at part 10, I think now, right? Part 10, we have 10 parts. This is good. this is I think like the longest series so far on the channel. Granted, it's like we haven't had a lot of mods. I think I've played a total of like 4, maybe. But yeah, this has been the longest. So, let's do this. So in the last episode, we were like, well, we told everyone about our plan to get Natsuki out of there. So that's what we're doing. Our plan was that we're gonna apparently go and then we're gonna like move all her stuff when her dad goes out, move all her stuff out of the house, and then I forgot what the rest of the plan was. Just leave her dad and just in disbelief, I guess. And we saw Yuri's being controlled by the book or something. See, I mentioned this in the last episode. I said that Yuri might be behind all of it. But you guys told me in the comments, some of you were saying that it might be the third eye that she's talking to. And like the portrait of Markov is controlling her. And I'm like, that could be the case. Forgot about that. Also, someone else pointed out that the "I'm going to tell everyone" wasn't just from that picture. That picture got it from the game. And I forgot, in the Amy Like Spiders poem, it ends with "and I'm going to tell everyone." So that's kind of probably what it's referencing. Not that picture in specific. The picture was referencing the game. But anyway, let's go. Oh shit, I just skipped something. We spend the next few days laying low, waiting for a moment of opportunity. Just acting normal. Walking to school like normal. Talking to my friends like normal. Taking classes like normal. Eating my lunch like normal. Going to literature club like normal. Planning for the open day like normal. Debating with Yuri, doting on Sayori. Sharing insights with Monica. Holding Natsuki's dainty, soft hand. All like normal. The normalness of it all is exhausting. Saturday looming large in the back of my mind. The enormity of what we're undertaking. Not to mention the potential consequences. Not being able to act until then is forcing my mind into a feedback loop, sapping my energy with every cycle. A cycle of planning, worrying, and reassuring. It's torturous. As is seeing her to the end of her street every day. Seeing her beautiful smile turn and walk away from me. Towards that place. The home she shares with him. Her tormentor. Her torturer. I just want to take her away right now. Just live in our own private little world. Somewhere he can't get to her. I can't imagine what she must be feeling right now. It'll be over soon, though. Just a little longer. That's the only strand of comfort I can cling to right now. Damn. Oh, Saturday has arrived. Oh my god, it's time, fellas. Mission a go. Finally. I can transfer all the nervous energy I've been building to something constructive. And best of all, Nasi's coming to live with me today. My mind drifts back to the night of our date. Man, neighbors are going to hate us. When she's having a good time, she is not quiet about it. Oh, God. Hey, dummy, what are you doing? I'm shaken from my reverie and my face is flushed from impure thoughts. Nasi places the box she's carrying at my feet. Come on, there's no time to be daydreaming.
Is this it for the bedroom?
Yep, we're almost done. Just one more trip, but the five of us should do it.
Nasi didn't really have a lot of stuff. It still would have been a struggle with just the two of us, but still. The five of us had coordinated well, and the task proved surprisingly quick to tackle. We should celebrate together after this. Everyone's done such a great job. Even Yuri, despite her initial opposition to the plan. I feel a tug on my sleeve.
Hey, what's going on in that head of yours?
Nothing. Just getting distracted. Come on, let's go and get the last few bits and pieces.
Yeah.
We all make the last trip over in record time. Monica and Sarah head off in fairly short order. I can hardly hold it against them. It's their first weekend together as a couple, after all.
Aww. Still forgot about that. It's so cute.
That feeling is still fairly fresh in my mind, so it's understandable. It just leaves me, Natsuki, and Yuri.
Shall I make some tea? Yes. I'd love a cup.
Yes, please.
I'll make a pot, then.
Thanks, Yuri.
While you're doing that, I'm gonna have a quick shower. I'm all gross from moving stuff.
No problem. See you in a bit. Natsuki heads upstairs while Yuri and I boil some water and make a pot of tea. Sitting around the kitchen table, we pour ourselves a cup each while we wait. Yuri?
Hmm?
Thanks. For today, I mean.
Zero.
I know you didn't like what we planned, but I also know you said what you said because you have Natsuki's best interests at heart. Thank you for being there for her, even if it means we disagree.
That's not it. That's not it at all. I've not been myself lately.
What do you mean?
You know how I feel about you, Zero, and that hasn't gone away. I thought I'd come to terms with it, but every so often, all I feel is anger and jealousy. But it's not me. It doesn't feel like me. It's not like I have no control over my body anymore.
Well, it's like I have no control over my body anymore.
And I'm trapped inside, screaming at myself to stop. You probably just think I'm making excuses.
No, Yuri, I don't. I think back to all the horrible stuff that's happened to us recently. There's a very good chance that she's experiencing some serious trauma as a result of all that. What kind of friend would I be if I just dismissed that? I promised myself that I would rebuild bridges with Yuri. Now it's time to start. I believe you. I'll do whatever it takes to get you through whatever it is you're going through. And make sure you always have a friend to talk to. Maybe you could stay with us some nights, and we could all walk to school together.
I'd like that. A lot.
And maybe in the club? We can finally read that book together. Aw, yeah, see, we can read the book! There you go. Make friends with Yuri. Don't love Yuri, friends with Yuri.
That would be lovely. Thank you, Zero.
Anything for a friend. Oh, that hurt her. Oh, that hurt.
A friend, yes. That'll take some getting used to, but I'm lucky to have someone like you.
Yuri's wistful look doesn't escape me. There's bound to be some awkwardness in the coming weeks. But we'll get through it. Eventually, Natsuki joins us and we drink tea together. Seeing the two of them together, talking and laughing together. It's a heartening sight to me, and I feel like maybe I've done some real good. Happiness in our literature club. A worthy goal, I think. The time eventually comes for Yuri to go home. The sun is just starting to set. And now begins our first night together, living under the same roof. Hey! The Emperor thoughts are back. I wonder if she's having them too.
Oh shoot! Zero!
What's wrong, Natsuki?
Have you seen my coat? I've looked through all my clothes and I can't find it.
I don't remember seeing it while we were packing, actually.
Aw, crap, I must have left it behind. I'm gonna dash back and grab it.
Is there time before...
He's not due back until early tomorrow morning.
Oh, good. Well, I'll see you in a little while, then. I'll make you some dinner when you get back, okay?
Yay!
You're such a good wife. I'll make you pay for that.
I'm definitely looking forward to that.
My cheeks flush as I grin involuntarily. Oh, jeez.
I'll see you later, okay?
Yeah, don't be long. She heads out the door, and I start rooting around the kitchen, gathering ingredients for her first meal under this roof. It's been an hour now. Oh, God! Oh, no. Why has she been gone for an hour? She can't still be looking for that coat, can she? 1 hour, 15 minutes. Is she okay? 1.5 hours. Where is she? I pick up the phone and select Natsuki's number from my contacts. Two rings, and the call is answered. What the fuck? Suffer! And then silence. The voice was distorted and muffled by static, but there's only one person that could have been. I run for the door, my heart pounding a million beats per minute. I fling open the door, the only light emanating from my porch. I squint down into the darkness in time to see a shape shambling out of the shadows, becoming more and more recognizable. Oh no. No. No, no, no. No! Oh my God! The shape stumbles into view. Beaten. Broken. The deep laceration on her chest spewing blood, only to be washed away by the rain. Oh my God! Oh no! Natsuki! What happened?
It was waiting for me.
Her breathing is heavy and her speech slurred. She can barely speak at all.
It was gonna kill me. Why? Why?
Tears flow from her eyes, one of which swollen shut. She limps forward, dragging her leg, whimpering in pain with every step.
Natsuki! No! God, no!
I dash forward, scooping Natsuki up. I can't believe it. He was home early. I should have known this could have happened. I should have seen it coming a million miles off. We got complacent. Just let our guard down once, and this is the price we've paid. Cradling her broken body, I carry her indoors. I lay her down on the sofa. Her breathing is shallow and erratic. Calling an ambulance is the first step. Police, too. After that, I busy myself trying to staunch the flow of blood from her chest wound. It's pretty deep and bleeding profusely. Shit! Shit, shit, shit! She needs proper treatment or she might die. That thought freezes the blood in my veins. I can only hope the ambulance arrives in time. I put pressure on the wound. That's what you're supposed to do, right? Right? She weakly holds onto my arm, lightly stroking it. She can't die. I'm not going to let that happen. Never. Never, never. What? What the fuck was that? The door? Shit! Oh my god. I know you've got her in there! Open up! Where is she? I know that voice. I haven't heard it in a while, and the usual jovial tone has been supplanted by screams of rage. But I recognize it all the same. Dr. Skarngu Shirai. Okay. You little prick! I'll kill you if you've done anything to her! Done anything to her? Done anything to her? How dare he? After what he's done? I run over to the front door and press my body against it, pushing back against Dr. Shirai's attempts to break through. My anger boils over. Fuck you! You have no right to be concerned about her! After everything you've done to her, not after this! So she did tell you. Figures. What do you mean by this? This renders me incredulous. I'm not sure what's more galling. His nonchalance about his past crimes? Or his apparent ignorance of Natsuki's current condition? What the hell do you think this is? You tried to kill her, you bastard! She's busy bleeding out on my couch because of you! What? His voice cracks. What did you say? I said she's dying because of what you did to her! The wound. Huh? The wound. Where is it and how deep is it? You should know! Listen, I don't know what she's told you. Most of it's probably true. But I've never tried to kill her. Not now, not ever. I decide to humor him. The worst one is down her chest next to her sternum. It's pretty deep and she's bleeding badly. Shit. Have you treated the wound at all? Gauze and pressure. That's a start, but The ambulances are overworked as it is. It could be too late. Let me in. I have a trauma kit in my car. I can save her. Are you kidding me? You're not going anywhere near her. Please, I'm begging you. Do you want her to die? I won't let her die, not like her mother. Look, if you let me in, I'll turn myself in. What? I'll do anything. I just can't lose her. Why? Why would he say that? Why would he just turn himself in when he spent all these years threatening Natsuki to cover for what he's done? For the life of his daughter? It's absurd, but he might be the only hope she's got. Fine. Oh my god, it was Yuri! Holy shit, I just thought of that! There's cut wounds! It was fucking Yuri! Yuri, under the control of the third eye, cut Natsuki! I swear to god, that's what it is! Oh, I swear to god! Carefully, I unlock the door. Backing off to stay out of arm's reach of him, I allow him to enter the house. Oh! Look at this dude! This man looks like a deadbeat! He stands before me, eyeing me up and down for a couple of seconds before pushing past me to get to the patient. Natsuki! He squats down next to her and checks her over, his eyes wide with worry. He turns to me. You! I need your help! Huh? Get down here and pass me the things I need. Got it? My face contorts in a snarl. Do you want her to save her or not? Swallowing my pride, I plop down next to him. As he sets about stabilizing her condition, he has me pass him various pieces of equipment and consumables. Watching him work on Natsuki, it's amazing. He's so skillful and precise in the way that he belies his disheveled appearance. Cleaning the wound, packing it, bandaging it. It's kind of a shame. A shame that he's an abusive asshole. Gritting my teeth, I continue to act as his gopher until finally, he sighs in relief. Phew. That ought to hold her until the ambulance arrives. She's not out of the woods yet, but this at least gives her a fighting chance. He marches over to the fridge and roots around, eventually taking one of my dad's beers and cracking it open. He slumps down to the floor, his back to the sofa where Natsuki lays resting. Her breathing is still ragged and shallow, but had slowed to a more regular pace. My own breathing returned to a semblance of normality. I crack a beer of my own and join Dr. Shirai on the floor. Ah, better enjoy one of these while I still can. So, how'd you find us anyway? He laughs mirthlessly. Don't think I didn't notice you sniffing around my daughter, young Master Zero. Walking her home and goodness knows what else. As for your address, that was easy. I just pulled it out from the surgery records. I had a feeling that you were going to be the beginning of the end, I guess. So when I came home early to find all of her things gone, I knew there was only one place she could be. Huh? So he always knew. The plan would have never worked. God damn it, Yuri was right. No matter her motivation for saying those things, she was on the money the whole time. I wish I'd listened to her. More awkward silence interspersed with drinking. Her mother. She died in childbirth. Yeah, Natsuki told me. It crushed me, but the only thing that kept me going was the thought that I've still got Natsuki. As soon as she hit puberty, I panicked. The same thing could happen to her. It's all I could think about. I couldn't bear to lose her like I lost her mother. So I set about making sure that would never happen. I kept her away from boys as much as I could, but I knew that wasn't going to work forever. So I began to starve her, hindering the growth of her secondary sexual characteristics. Oh, that's why he starves her! So that she wouldn't look appealing. The hope that she wouldn't be able to get pregnant in the first place. Oh, that too. But then she just started to ask questions. I couldn't let her tell anyone. I didn't want to hurt her. It just seemed like the only way. So it went on and on. I'm so tired, Zero. I can't do this anymore. I sit there listening, completely dumbstruck. Is he telling me that all of the horrible things he did were really out of love? Misguided love, but love nonetheless? My mouth flaps as I try to find the words to express what I'm feeling right now. That bastard. Does he even know what Natsuki's dream is? Can she still... He shakes his head. Probably not, no. Oh my god! No! She can't even give birth? Oh no! You know you've probably ruined her life, right? Discerns me a sad sigh. I'm not here for your forgiveness, Zero. In fact, I was originally here to kick your ass. Here we are, and I just figured I owe you an explanation of some kind. I don't like you. You're soft, cocky, and a bit dense. But you're all she's got now. Suddenly, he shoots me an intense look. You find out who did this to her, you hear? I knew it wasn't him! Oh my god! I knew it wasn't him! I have to depend on you now. That's gonna be a hell of a task. If he was there and came straight here, then Natsuki didn't even make it all the way home before she was attacked. And if it wasn't Dr. Shirai, then who was it that hurt her? Sirens blaring outside herald the arrival of the emergency services. Dr. Shirai gets up and straightens his shirt. Well, that looks like my cue to exit. What? I thought you were going to turn yourself in! Come on, Zero. I think we both know there's only one way this can end. Look after her, okay? Don't let her die. Before I can manage another word, he bolts for the back door as the ambulance crew knocks on the front. Natsuki stirs in her half-conscious stupor.
Dad, I hate you.
Aw. Once we got to the hospital, she was immediately admitted. Who is her next of kin? They asked. Of course, now technically that was me. They listed off her injuries, one by one. Multiple lacerations and contusions. Concussion. Broken ribs. Detached retina. Torn ligament in her ankle. Whoever had done this to her had really gone to town on her. And all we can do is wait until she's better before we can ask her about the incident. After discussing with the doctor what her father had told me, they also found her to be severely malnourished. She was beginning to show signs of a number of vitamin deficiency diseases. She was still unconscious when I left, but the doctor was sure that she'd make a full recovery. The first doctor she'd seen in 18 years that wasn't her father! That thought still hasn't sunk in. When I'd arrived home, the police were waiting for me. They'd found Dr. Shirai dead in his home. Oh my god! I was told his bloodstream contained large amounts of something called pentobarbital. Apparently it's a drug used for anesthesia. They said they were ruling it as a suicide. Oh, so he committed suicide, I figured. They had found him clutching Natsuki's coat, the only one of her belongings she'd left behind. Bastard! I wanted him to face justice! And I hated him. I still do. But to go out like this... Now I'm home, surrounded by Natsuki's belongings, but no Natsuki. I can even smell her on everything around me. It's maddening. The dreams I'd have of what we'd be doing tonight have quickly been rendered to dust. And so I spent the night alone, staring at the ceiling, wishing she was here. That's it! Oh my god. Oh. Holy shit. Oh my god, that was a roller... Oh my fuck, that was a roller coaster. Urban, if you're watching this, I fucking love you, dude. I love you so much. I love you. I love your mod. I don't know, man. Oh my god. Bro, I don't know what to say. I love this mod. I love it so much. Oh my god. So, Natsuki's father is like a dickhead. And he knows he's a dickhead, but he somewhat had good intentions. But he's still an asshole. So, I swear, it was Yuri. It had to be Yuri. Because there was cut marks and everything. It had to be Yuri under the control of the portrait of Markov. Because she said she hasn't been herself recently. There's cuts. Yuri has knives. It makes sense. I think it was Yuri. But Jesus Christ, man. Natsuki was fucked up. That hurt to look at. This entire thing hurt, man. Also hurt my voice to do those, too. Ah. And I just burped. Unprofessional piece of shit, but... Jesus. Now I have to wait for the next... I have to wait for the next version, bro! Oh! This mod's amazing. That is... My lord. I have to end the episode here, I guess, but just... Okay, actually, let me say some things. So, since Summer Hope is basically over now, until the next update, and we're waiting on Just Natsuki for August 1st, I guess I'll play Coldest Summer. That looked like an interesting mod, so I might play that. And yeah, probably just play that. Maybe I'll play some shorter mods in between as well. But yeah, that's the end of this episode. I hope you guys enjoyed. This is Zero. Peace. I'm a chef-shifter.